You can tell that Easter is on the way because now we have hot cross buns for sale in our favourite tea room here in Lech Wenlock. And apparently, we are the first ones to try them. So here is fresh hot cross bun, which I'm now going to sample live for you. Oh my goodness. It's so fruity. And lots of cinnamon as well, my favourite ingredient. So Easter is coming and the hot cross buns have arrived. Welcome to today's live stream. I hope you are feeling well. We are back, we are here, we are live. Where are you? Oh, there you are, over there. Can you see them, Steve, over there? They're watching us. They're spying on us. What are they up to? I wonder. Hi, everybody. This is Mr. Duncan and also
Mr. Steve.
Mr. Steve is here after his little absence because he was busy. By the way, we are going to take a look at what Mr. Steve was doing last night. He was performing in front of a big audience and it was a lot of fun. And I was there as well. Hi, everybody. I hope you are well today. If you didn't need reminding, you might need reminding that spring is in the air. And look at that behind right now. That is out of the window looking outside and all of the cherry blossom has come out and it is starting to feel like spring. We had a very interesting walk yesterday, didn't we?
We did, yes. We decided to go on a nice sort of easy walk in. That the sun was out, it was beautiful.
It was lovely,
but
we got halfway and then it started raining and it was a very, very long, prolonged, I like that word, prolonged, something that goes on longer than you expect. It is prolonged and it was a rainstorm. And it was rainy, but it was very strange. I didn't feel stressed by it. I found it somehow therapeutic. I don't know why. It felt nice being out there. The air, the fresh air. I don't know what it is. If you're outside when it rains, the air is very clear and it does something to you, even though we did get a little bit.
Well, we had to shelter under a tree.
We got wet.
Thankfully, there was no lightning. But yes, it was pouring down. There were floods. When we got into Lech Wenlock, there were floods all over the roads and big puddles. But we dried off nicely in the tea shop.
Yeah, so we went for a cup of coffee and we had a hot cross bun as well. Very nice. And if you needed reminding that Easter is coming, I think it's actually on April the 9th. The 9th of April for us is Easter Sunday. Of course, we will be with you on Easter Sunday. Ooh. As long as nothing happens between now and then. I suppose we should address the thing that has happened this week. Sadly, for those who don't know, my mother passed away on Thursday after a long illness, suffering from Alzheimer's. And Thursday morning, sadly, she passed away. And I have to say, it was not good news. And I suppose now I feel, I don't know what the feeling is. It's very strange. I think everyone faces these this sort of situation in a different way. Some people are quite distraught. Some people feel numb. And I suppose that's one of the feelings that I have. I feel slightly numb from it. But also, and this is going to sound weird to some people, I feel strangely relieved. Because I always thought that for the past 3 years, my mother was suffering. It's not a very nice situation to be in. If you see someone who is suffering from Alzheimer's or dementia, it is quite heartbreaking because you do lose that person, even though they are still alive. So sadly, on Thursday, my mum passed away, and now we are arranging the funeral and all of the things to go with it. And if you needed irony today, it's also Mother's Day here in the UK.
Of course, we both lost our mothers, haven't we, Mr. Duncan? So we're both motherless.
So 6 months ago, 6 months ago, Steve lost his mum. And here we are 6 months later, also talking about my mum. But I think with your mother, it was a little different because it was sudden.
Yes, it was relatively sudden. So a bit more of a shock. But for yourself, of course, we've had a few sort of false alarms when we thought your mother was basically on a deathbed, but yes, then she recovered again, which often happens with people with Alzheimer's. But yes, sad day for both of us, really, but we want to be cheered up.
Yes. Well, this is where I want to thank you. Now, if you are lucky enough to have someone in your life, a friend or maybe a relative or maybe a partner, someone who is there for you, all I can say is you are very lucky. And I feel that I'm lucky because I have Steve, who was really, really good. And last night,
as you were with me, Mr. Duncan.
Yes.
Last, 6 months ago.
Last night we went out. Now, I didn't feel like going out, but Mr. Steve is in a show and I couldn't resist. I thought, no, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go and see Mr. Steve in his show because you put a lot of work into it because you had to do it all very quickly.
I did for this one.
And I have to say, it was a wonderful experience. I came away feeling really happy. I had a smile on my face. Mr. Steve said, you had a big smile. And it was fun seeing Steve perform. We might have a little look at this now. Would you like to see Mr. Steve performing on the stage? By the way, we are looking at anniversaries today because for me it is a big anniversary as well. Everything is happening today on the 19th of March. Everything, all sorts of things are going on. We have anniversaries. But last night we went to see Mr. Steve in a very unusual place, really strange place. It used to be, the place where Mr. Steve was performing last night used to be a courthouse, and all of the original fittings are still there. So the courthouse still actually exists, even though it's not used anymore. I think they often use it for weddings. So there it is. So I arrived early with Mr. Steve, and you can see there are people. There's Brian May. Look, from Queen. Isn't that nice? It's very nice that Brian May came.
Where's that? Oh.
and you might spot Mr. Steve. Sadly, I can't play the sound because of, well, you know, copyright strikes and all of that on YouTube. But there is Steve singing. But I must admit, the building that you performed in was very unusual because it was standing on stilts.
Yes.
It was raised above the ground. And there he is, looking so happy. And I have to say, your smile last night, there it is. It really warmed my heart.
So, so the first half, just for, so that people know, the first half was a concert. So we were in, I was wearing a black shirt. The second half was Gilbert and Sullivan, Trial by Jury, if anybody knows that.
So it's a very short play as well, a very short performance.
40 minutes.
Yes.
And strangely enough, it is all about being sued, which is an interesting concept.
That's what I was going to mention. The strange thing is, this is an old courthouse, and this part of the show was set in a courtroom. So I thought that was amazing.
Yes, and death in the courtroom. That's right. And it's strangely enough, the court case is about somebody who was supposed to get married to a lady. So they got engaged.
Mm-hmm.
And then he broke off the engagement.
Oh, naughty.
And up until the 1970s, a woman could sue the man if she broke off an engagement.
Oh, I see.
You were allowed, because you'd sort of promised that you were going to marry this girl, you were engaged. But if the man was to break it off, the woman could take the man to court and for compensation, for damages,
Quite interesting. So if you promise yourself to someone and say, I will marry you, it's a sort of contract.
It was, like a contract almost. Mm. And until, I think it was 1970, even in this country, if a marriage was broken off by the man, then the woman could sue for damages.
Incredible.
Or financial compensation.
Huh,
that doesn't happen now. And this was written about 1870, this particular. And I had to dress up to look young. Hence me wearing that particular outfit. Normally he's in a smart suit, but we decided to do it slightly differently.
Can I tell the story about when you turned up for the one of the rehearsals? They didn't recognise you. They thought you were some young person.
Yes, because obviously if I went to a normal rehearsal bald, they think you're probably in your 50s or something. Turn up with a baseball cap on and a sports top, and suddenly, where's Steve? We can't start yet. He's not here.
Yeah,
I'm here, because they hadn't seen me, because I didn't. This group didn't know me. I'd only joined them 2 weeks ago.
That's it. So Steve, what Steve actually did was step in, because one of their members had dropped out. He couldn't do the show. So Steve very kindly offered to step in to that man's place in his stead.
Because I've done this role before. This was in Bridgnorth, a town called Bridgnorth, which is only 20 minutes drive from Much Wenlock. So you can look that up if you wanted to look up Bridgnorth Town Hall.
Or, yes.
If you were interested, you would be able to see this fairly unique building. There's only two of its kind, I think, in the UK, where it's built on stilts,
yes,
concrete stilts, and the cars can go underneath.
Yeah. But the strange thing is that the stairs going in are dreadful. They are really steep. And we did notice yesterday, as we were leaving, a lot of the elderly members of the audience were having a great deal of trouble getting down the stairs. I don't know how they got up the stairs, to be honest, Steve, but when they were coming down, a lot of them were really struggling. So I would say that it is not very disabled friendly.
No, the building's hundreds of years old and there was only one toilet. So there were long queues for the toilets. And I remember yesterday, on Friday night was the opening night,
mm-hmm,
the first performance, and I needed to go to the toilet in the break. and I couldn't get in. They had to wait for me to go to the toilet before they could start the book. Because I said, you can't start yet. I need the toilet.
That wasn't that. Because last night somebody had to.
Yes, last night we were held up because one toilet and there was about 200 people there. So it was quite.
Well, that's the other thing I couldn't get over, how many people were there. And it was such a good performance. And you've never performed with this group before, is that right?
That's correct. I knew one or two of the people in it, but yeah, I hadn't performed with them before.
So it's interesting that Steve joined in with this group he didn't really know. And it was such a lot of fun. And I was feeling unhappy. I was feeling a little down after Thursday's event. And it cheered me up no end. It was very infectious, the whole atmosphere. The performance and seeing Steve on the stage dancing and jumping around. What more could you want?
And I remembered everything. I didn't forget didn't forget anything. Well, I forgot one little thing you might not have noticed though, but I think
your voice has really improved. It was really nice.
Well, I am paying for lessons, so it should be doing something. A lot of people are saying condolences for your for your mother. Marwa was the first person to say it before you even mentioned it, in fact. So thank you for all your lovely messages that you've sent to Mr. Duncan. I was going to say something else then. Yes, we've got some new people on as well, Mr. Duncan.
Oh, hello.
We've got Osma from Pakistan, who is declaring that this is his first time on the live stream.
Hello, Osma.
So welcome to you. Hope you're enjoying it so far. And we've got somebody who's calling themselves the Incredible Hulk.
Well, they might be.
They might well be, yes.
Just don't get too angry. If we make you angry today, please don't tear off your clothes and run around the neighbourhood.
Ali Baba is on as well, who said that from Vietnam, I've known you since 2008.
Wow.
So, yeah, we'll be talking about anniversaries in a minute.
Yes, because, well, first of all, today, the 19th of March, I don't know why, but everything seems to have come together today, all of these anniversaries. So let's just see. It is the 19th of March. It is Mother's Day.
Yes.
Mothering Sunday. It's also the anniversary of the beginning of the Iraqi War. It's the right day when the US and the coalition bombed Baghdad. It's also the day, on the same day that happened, by the way, 20 years ago, I got on an aeroplane and went to China to work. And I stayed there for a few years working as an English teacher. So on this very day, I don't know why, but everything seems to have come together.
Like a meeting, an intersection point, a conflagration. Is that the word?
I don't know.
I'm not quite sure, but
a
yes.
A conflagration.
I think I pronounced that correct. Let's move on. Yes, it is Cherry Blossom behind us. Another Christina asked.
Yes.
And Jimmy's asked. Yes, it's Cherry Blossom.
Yeah. It's real, by the way. That's out of the window right now. And it's windy. We've got a bit of wind, but it's quite mild, to be honest with you. It's not exactly cold. And yes, that is the cherry blossom that has come out over the past two or three days, and I couldn't resist having it as the background.
Apparently it's cold in Italy, so it's very warm here. It's about 12 degrees outside or something like that. I mean, I've been out in the garden in a t-shirt. So we're having better weather by the sounds of it than Italy. And where Claudia is, so they're having a storm.
Hello, Claudia.
In Buenos Aires. So there's all sorts of things going on all over the place. So, yeah.
A place at the moment that is hot is Spain. Apparently Spain, can you believe it? I think it's 16 years since Spain or parts of Spain had any heavy rainfall. So the drought that is going on at the moment in Spain has been going on for a long time. And there was a very interesting news report the other night talking about this, how all of the reservoirs and all of the water levels of where the drinking water is stored has dropped. I think it's about 25% less water, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it is a lot when you go for the whole total of all of the water that is there for drinking. So imagine that here, if we suddenly lost 25% of all of our water to drink. So hello, Spain. We are thinking about you. We will try our best to send some of our British rain to you. We will try our best.
Well, interesting enough, Mr. Duncan, yes. I forgot what I was going to say then, but my brain's gone blank. I'm so tuned into singing music at the moment. It's about the only thing I can remember.
Can I say hello to Semi? Hello, Semi. Semi Boskurt, who says you had a close friend in China. Well, I had quite a few close friends. Is that right, Mr. Duncan? Yes, you went for a pizza. You went to Pizza Hut with them. And he was Mr. Zhang Wei. Yes.
Oh.
Well, he is now living in Australia and he has a successful career working in a hospital. So now he is a fully trained nurse and he works in Melbourne. So he lives there now. So a long way from China and that's where he lives right now. So yes, well remembered. There is a video of myself in China having a pizza with my friend Wilfred, or Winfried as he liked to be known, Zhang Wei. And he was also the person who helped me when I was filming some of my very early videos in China way back in 2006. But remember, in 2003, it's very strange, Steve, in 2003 there was no social media. It did not exist in any form. Isn't it strange?
Even in 2008 it didn't exist.
Yes, most we often think that social media was around for a very long time, but in 2003 there was nothing. There was no YouTube, there was no Facebook, there was no Instagram, there was definitely no Twitter, and there was no TikTok, definitely.
I mean, yes, because this has come up recently, because if one or two of you follow the financial news, I'm only going to do this briefly, Mr. Duncan, you might have noticed there's been a few bank failures recently, which is causing some concern. I think Silicon Valley Bank, they're beginning to think that there is another problem in the banking sector like there was in 2008, maybe possibly another crisis.
There's a surprise.
Yes. So what they're saying is that because of social media now, back in 2008, if you wanted to get your money out of a bank, which is what happened then, people got scared that they're going to lose all their money because the banks were going to fold, then you had to physically go into the bank. So you saw lots of people queuing up to go and get their money out. But it's happening. But these banks have literally been failing almost overnight recently, because people can now get on social media and say, look, have you got money in this bank? I'd get it out if I were you. And then what can happen is you can transfer money now instantly on an app on your phone.
Well, yes.
Couldn't do that in 2008. So everyone suddenly tries to draw their money out. And these crises, you know, people are a bit worried about it at the moment.
So that was in 2008.
2008, we didn't have social media. I couldn't believe that.
Yeah, I think. Now, I'm going to slightly correct you, Steve.
Yes.
Just a little bit. But Facebook did exist in 2008.
Okay.
But it wasn't the big monster that it is now. And of course, there was still no Twitter in 2008. I think all of these things were in their early stages. But yes, you're right. And of course, one of the big, I suppose you could call it an evolution, is going from physical to digital, which of course means that instead of queuing outside the door of your local bank, you can now just go online very quickly and withdraw your money. And that's what lots of people were doing last week. So one or two banks at the moment are having difficulties. It's not quite as bad, though. They're saying it's not as bad.
They're saying it's not as bad, but there's another bank in Switzerland, Credit Suisse.
Can I just say, it's not as bad as 2008.
Not yet.
So we're not here. No, I'm just trying to stop doing what you were just talking about. So we're not here to cause panic, by the way. Please don't blame us. If any more banks go under over the next 24 hours and they blame us, it's not our fault. So this is not like 2008. Can I just make that clear?
Well,
in case anyone...
We're not. Yeah. Is anybody from Switzerland watching today? Because the last place you expect a bank to have problems is in Switzerland, because you think of Switzerland as being this very conservative, solid rule, following rules. Everybody's very conforming. Everything's very conservative. You wouldn't imagine that a bank in Switzerland would have a financial problem, but it has been having problems for a number of years.
And very delicious chocolate.
Very delicious chocolate, yeah. So that's, you know, if that goes under, that'll be it's not.
Yeah. Again,
we're not financial experts.
Steve, yes, this is the moment where we stop talking about that subject, because we know nothing about it, and we're not experts. So please don't panic. Please don't... You can just hear people now all tapping on their bank accounts.
Well, then they'd listen to us, really.
Yeah, I mean, please don't listen to us with that. So no panic.
Pedro's on for a while, but he can't stay because he's got internet problems.
Oh, yes. Okay.
So we welcome you here for how, even if it's only briefly. Yeah, enjoy the rest of your day.
Good.
But everybody else, you must stay. Tom Rock says he's going to the bank to draw all his money out.
Yes. Well, you joke about this, though, but Steve's joking about this. And this is what happened in 1997 with Asia. In Asia, when the Asia banking system collapsed, it was one person. Do you remember George Soros started speculating about the Asian banking system, and then everyone started pulling all of their money out of Asia, and then the next day it was collapsing all around everyone.
Yes.
So it is true. You have to, especially in this modern day and age, you have to be very careful what you say when you're influencing people to do things.
Yes, and the other Bruno makes a comment about various banks. Of course, what people don't realise, and I didn't realise this, is that you think a banks loan out money, don't they? They make money from loaning out money.
Mm-hmm.
So they get, but you think that they would have, and people put their savings in there. So you would think a bank would always have enough money in reserve.
Is that called liquidity?
Yes. Well, not quite. But you would think that a bank, say all the people that save money in a bank, you would think that if they wanted their money back, if you wanted your money back, you would think that they would have plenty of, you know, notes in the back somewhere in a big vault to pay everybody back. But that's not how banking works, apparently.
Isn't it?
No, they never have. They only have it's called fractional reserve banking. So they only keep a fraction of money in deposits to pay back, because they never expect everybody will want all their money back at once.
Well, no, I would imagine on an average day, that's a little bit like if you run a shop. You have a very good weekend, and then everyone comes back to the shop to return all of the goods, and then suddenly your following week will be nothing. You will have no profit whatsoever because it will cause a huge dent. So that thing you weren't expecting. So I suppose it's similar to that.
But no, well, you could at least pay those people back for bringing the money back. But if everybody in any bank anywhere, if everybody wants all their money back, the banks never have enough money in reserve.
Yes, that's it.
And they hold a lot of deposits in what's the word I'm looking for? In government bonds.
Hmm.
And they can't just cash those in. And at the moment, bonds have dropped in value.
Anyway,
this is what's happened to that. But I don't know. I'm just saying. Yeah. But you would think that you would be able to get your money back, but you can't because they don't. They don't have. They never.
That's it. The thing you just said.
Yes.
Literally, you're explaining it again. It's like we're in some sort of loop.
They're loaning more money than they've got in savings.
Once again, there's no panic. Please don't panic.
Never used to be like that.
It's not all right, Steve. It's not 2008. It's not 2008, it's 2023, and at this moment in time, everything's not too bad. Even though they are arresting Donald Trump, apparently, on Tuesday.
Well, do you know what the other thing I read found out today?
What did you find out today, Steve?
That Silicon Valley Bank. Do you know what? They have guaranteed that everybody who's got money is going to be paid back. Now, normally, you're only insured up to a certain amount.
Okay.
And after £250,000 is you're insured with in America with a bank. Mm. Anything over that, then if the bank goes bust, you lose it. But they've decided that they're going to give the money back to everybody. And some companies have got billions in there. And do you know why they're doing it?
Tell me, Steve.
Because a lot of the people that have deposited money in that bank, apparently...
Oh no! Wait there a second. This is not conspiracy things.
No, it's not conspiracy. Yeah, no, they donate money to political parties.
Well, that's yeah.
So they're bailing them out.
Okay, Steve, got to stop.
No. It's not.
No. That's it. We'll leave that. We'll leave that for the rednecks.
This isn't the paper, Mr. Duncan. Yes. This isn't a conspiracy theory.
Yes, we'll just...
We're not
here to do that, Steve.
They're out because they're helping out the government.
Yes. Well, surprise, surprise.
Well, exactly, yes.
Are you surprised, Steve?
Yeah.
Have you heard that? Apparently people in government are corrupt. I'm shocked. I don't know about you, but I'm really shocked to find out that.
Bruno makes a funny comment here. Mm-hmm. You lend banks your money with virtually no security, but when you go to a bank, they chain their pens to the counter so that you can't take them.
Yeah,
That's true.
I think Jerry Seinfeld did a big bit about that.
Yes, they can't even give you a pen.
Oh. But then that's because people would just keep stealing them. They would probably have a huge loss on pens that they have to keep giving out all the time or putting on the counter. So I can understand that.
Anyway, right, we've got to teach something, Mr. Duncan.
I think it's very good that banks are putting their pens on chains. Not that they need to nowadays, because no one goes into the bank. We don't have a bank now in Much Wenlock. We don't have one.
No.
We don't even have a bank. We used to have three banks in Much Wenlock: Barclays, Lloyd's, and the other one, which I can never remember the name of. But they're all gone now. Gone.
Yeah, we've got a cash point, but that's it.
Yes.
Because people aren't going to banks anymore. They're doing it all online or on their mobile phone apps.
I don't know how elderly people manage, because that I would imagine that would have been a good thing for them. Oh, it's okay.
Mr. Duncan, please hold my pen.
Please stop tapping it.
You're getting very, very annoyed easily today.
No, I'm not. Steve has this habit. You can't see this. He has a habit, and he just taps his pen up and down while I'm talking.
Oh.
Right under me. And I'm trying to sort of present, and he's there going...
Well, you shouldn't be so easily distracted.
No.
Something I discovered recently about banks, Mr. Duncan, is that if you want to withdraw money now...
Yeah.
Any substantial amounts of money. Oh, say you wanted to buy something and you wanted to draw $1,000, but you can't do it online anymore.
Okay.
You have to do it through the app on the phone. My bank told me.
Yeah.
They wouldn't let me do it.
Well, I will tell you why that's so. Because they invest millions and millions in apps. All of these banks and all of these big companies, they put lots and lots of money into these phone apps to actually develop them and run them. So there is someone somewhere who has to operate all of that. It's a bit like having a website, but much more expensive. So if the customers don't use those apps, they are basically wasting money. So that's the reason why they always try to push you towards using the applications on your phone for your banking and anything, to be honest. So everyone has an app nowadays. We don't, by the way. We don't have an app, do we?
Well, I've had to have an app. Oh, you mean for this?
Well, yes, this thing now.
Well, why would you need an app for this?
Well, people do. All of the big English teachers now have their own app.
Well, maybe you should get one.
Well, I can't afford it. It costs... I seem to be going around in circles. It costs a lot of money to have an app made for you and then run it, because you have to pay monthly for the app to be run.
Oh.
Like a website. So it's expensive.
But I phoned up the bank and said, because I was trying to draw some money out, and they said, oh, no, you've got to do it on an app on the phone. And I said, well, surely that's less secure than me going onto my laptop at home and transferring money. But they said, oh, no, you've got to use the app. So I had to, well, if my, you know, I would have thought the app on the phone was far less secure than me going on my own laptop at home.
Yeah. Well, it's double, you have double identification now. So you have to have your bank account and your phone in front of you. I think it's called two-point verification now. So you have to tell them that you're there, and then they send something to your phone, which is really annoying, because you know your phone's never nearby, is it?
No.
Whenever you have to do that, your phone is never nearby. You have to then run around and try to find your phone. So it is quite secure, but they want you to use it because they're paying massive amounts of money for it, so they have to show that it's useful to people, unfortunately. Anyway, I didn't think we were going to talk about banks today. I really
this
didn't.
This is what happens.
But there is something I would like to talk about. We are talking about anniversaries. By the way, we are only here for a short time today for obvious reasons, and we will be going in about 20 minutes. But today is an anniversary, and I thought it would be interesting to have a look at some words and phrases connected to anniversaries. That makes sense when you think about it. Anniversary words and phrases. Don't worry, I'm not going to give you lots and lots of words and phrases. I sometimes get complaints about that. So we're looking at anniversaries. We often think of anniversaries, don't we? I don't know what happened then. Something very strange just happened to my... what happened then? Very strange.
Not sure, Mr.
My computer just did something very strange. An anniversary can be positive, such as a wedding or maybe a birthday. Or it can be negative, something tragic. And I suppose a year from last Thursday, so next year, we'll probably be not very happy. We'll be thinking of something sad as well, as you will be, of course, on September the 8th.
Mm.
Is that right?
Is it the 8th or the 10th? Blimey, oh, I can't 10th. Remember already.
Yes, no, September the 8th is the Queen.
Yes.
So there is another weird thing. It was the Queen on September the 8th and then your mother on the 10th. So these things are always going to get confused now.
That's life.
It is. And also the opposite as well. So an anniversary, I know what I've done. I've just deleted one of my things accidentally. I'm sorry. I'm being a bit of an idiot today. We commemorate, Mr. Steve. We also remember.
Mm-hmm.
We pay tribute. Oh, here's an interesting word. We venerate. Ooh. Have you heard of that before?
Of course I have, Mr. Duncan.
Venerate.
Veneration. You venerate something, yes. You celebrate it, don't you?
Well, it's kind of you pay respects or you honour. So to venerate is more of a solemn remembrance, maybe to those who fell during a certain period of war, maybe the First World War, Second World War, and all of the other wars that have happened and are still happening, I suppose. And we honour as well. So I think honour is a nice word. I have to be honest with you. I do like that word, honour. You honour someone or you honour a group of people, maybe someone who made a sacrifice in their life.
You honour their memory.
Yes. So I think that's quite a nice word, to be honest.
And you might do that by going out for a meal or going to, like my sister is today, she's going to my mother's graveside to put flowers down. She's taking her family. We're not going today, but just because it's impractical today. But, you know, you don't have to be there physically. But my sister's going. She's going to honour my mother's memory.
Mm.
And she's going to do that on my behalf as well.
And I'm pretty sure we'll be going over soon anyway. So we haven't forgotten. But it is Mother's Day. And if your mother is still around, you are lucky. Phone her. Send her an email or an SMS. Send her a card. Or go round and give her a big hug for us, please.
Rosa says, can we use pay tribute in a sentence? Yes, you could say, right, so somebody's died, you're all going out for a meal, maybe you're going on the anniversary of somebody's death, and you say, let's pay tribute to my mother, let's raise a glass and say, to you, Mum.
Hmm.
So you're paying tribute.
Yes.
That's how you do it. Somebody would normally say, let's pay tribute to a person or an event or something like that. It just means that you're remembering something and you're doing it in a sort of a solemn way.
Mm.
But you could be paying tribute to something that's, you know, positive.
Yes.
But usually it's something negative.
Well, tribute is often negative. So we pay tribute maybe to a celebrity who has just died. Maybe we show some of their work. Or maybe we talk about that person's life. So tribute is something that you are normally paying or normally doing as a mark of respect. So tribute. Or maybe, of course, I think sometimes you can have the pop music or bands they can form and they copy the original person's music.
Yes.
And we often call them a tribute band. So it's not the original band. It is someone who maybe sounds like them or sometimes looks like them, but it's not them. So they are a tribute band. So you pay homage. Hello, Tomek. Hello, Tomek. Tomek is here.
Tomek is celebrating an anniversary as well.
Oh.
Today, 5 years at wherever he's working. And I think that's probably today.
The mysterious place.
Or just celebrated my 5th working anniversary wherever he's working at the moment. And it's nice to celebrate work anniversaries. And that pops up a lot on social media. Please help celebrate such and such a person 5 years at this company or 10 years at this company. And companies normally mark certain years, don't they? 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. And you will normally get some kind of award. You might get a financial reward. You might just say get a certificate at 5 years. You might get some money at 10 years and some more money at 20. I remember when I'd done 20 years, I think I got £1,000.
Oh, okay.
From the company.
That's nice. You should have stayed for another 20 years.
I know, it's not much really for 20 years, is it really?
But no, but you should have stayed another 20 years and £1,000 at the end of it. I think that's worthwhile.
I don't think they've got one for 30. I don't think anybody ever stays that long. Yes. But that's it. So, yeah, it's nice to celebrate work anniversaries, particularly if you enjoy working there.
So, which most people don't. they probably mark the anniversary, but they have a tribute to their lost freedom, maybe. So a significant date or time is often remembered. A life-changing event might form an anniversary. So that also might be something positive or negative. Something that is life-changing isn't always good, is it? It can be a negative thing or a positive thing. Talking of which...
Yes, for example, I was going to say a life-changing event. It could be, it was a year ago that I had my serious car accident. Or a year ago that I was stopped treatment for cancer or something like that. It could be, it could be a life-changing event, as you say, Mr. Duncan. It could be something that you remember.
Yes.
In that way.
It was a year ago since I lost my virginity. Again.
Tom says, condolence. The word condolence. No, you're not talking about actual a condolence word said in actual days of death.
Yes, well, it's when a person dies.
Yes, you just say, oh, please accept my condolences.
It is, yes, it's you offering your sympathy.
Sympathy and kind words. It's often said in a card. It's not specific to particular time. Although, if somebody had died and you were going to send a condolence card, you would want to do it within a few days.
Yes, you don't send it a year later.
No, you wouldn't do it every year. You would just send it. Condolences is if somebody's died or if someone's seriously ill, usually when they've died.
Well, that is a pretty serious illness.
Yes, but I mean, I'm just saying, if somebody just sort of caught COVID, you wouldn't send a condolence card. But if they were... Yes, if someone was diagnosed with terminal cancer, would you send a... No, you would probably still wait until they died.
What? I'm sorry to hear that you're dying.
Saturino says, yes, we can celebrate retiring.
I don't think that's a card that will ever be made.
You could say, fine, that's... Yeah. Yeah, thanks, Regina.
Sorry?
Regina Gomez.
Okay. My hearing isn't very good today.
Okay.
What?
Yes, it's not a conspiracy. Exactly. That's how, yeah, exactly that. Right, right. Oh, Tomek was promoted 10 months ago.
Oh.
Are you CEO of that company? Maybe you are, yes.
But I think that's one heck of a promotion.
Yes. Well, it's something to celebrate.
Yes.
But you see, in 2 months' time, you can celebrate your anniversary of your promotion to CEO of the company. So there we go. Yes. That'll be the anniversary, which happens every year.
Anniversary. I'm in a weird mood today.
Annie from Annual every year, isn't it?
Yes, from the word annus.
Yes,
annus, which Pardon? Means is oh, the right. year, of course, which is where which is where it all comes from. Oh dear!
It's very dry in Italy, apparently, as well. I've got all the rivers are drying up in Italy as well as Spain.
So well, I suppose it's sort of the same sort of area, isn't it? So I think it is hot. It's very hot around the Balkans. Ooh, I know the feeling. I get very hot around my Balkans sometimes.
Yes, Giovanni, we'll always remember the anniversary of the Queen's death, of course. Yeah. Yes.
They're not going to let us forget, to be honest. I mean, we've got Prince Charles becoming King Charles in a few weeks from now, even though we get 3 days holiday. Not that it makes much difference to us, really, but there you go. So, no, we're never going to forget because they're not going to let us.
And thus, I will never forget my mother.
That's it.
Because 2 days later, obviously, you know, anyway, we won't go into that.
To make matters worse, I can guarantee that at some point, the day my mother passed will be on Mother's Day.
Yeah.
So that's going to eventually happen. So that day will eventually be on Sunday, and it will eventually be Mother's Day. On the anniversary of that.
I don't even know what date it is today. Is it the 14th, something like
that? It is
that?
Not. It is the 19th.
The 19th, right, okay. I've been... But do you know, when you get really busy with things, you lose track of the days. The last 2 weeks, because I've been in two separate shows, I've lost all track of the days. You know, what day are we? Monday? I've sort of... Lost? Does that happen to you sometimes? You forget what day it is when you've been so busy doing things and involved with things, and your normal routine is upset. So you do something differently on a different day. Because I've been to rehearsals and things. Like Saturdays, we normally do. Last Saturday, I had a matinee performance, so that was in the afternoon. So normally on a Saturday, we'd walk into town. But that's our routine for years. But because we didn't do that last Saturday, I've lost all track of what the days are. Mm. And I don't know what's happened to this last week. It's sort of gone. It's vanished very quickly.
It's been, well, let's just say it's been a hell of a week. And leave it at that, to be honest.
I think the busier you are, time does pass quickly.
OK, Steve, we've got 8 minutes and I've got 145 photographs to show you. So today is the anniversary of me going to China. And I had to mark it somehow. I had to make sure that I could celebrate that as an anniversary, because 20 years ago, we said goodbye to each other for a while. And I went to China. And I have to say, it went to see me first. True. And then a year later, I came back because I was missing Steve so much, and not because of anything else. So here, would you like to see this photograph, Steve? Look at this. This is the first photograph I took. After arriving in China, I was in Beijing and I was walking around near a place called Tiananmen Square.
God, what the quality?
Those days, we didn't have Bluetooth. We didn't have Bluetooth in 2003. We couldn't just connect easily. We didn't have the cloud. That didn't exist in 2003. So there I am, arrived in China, standing in Beijing and really feeling a little... Well, I suppose the word is shell-shocked. I was really sort of feeling a little disorientated, if I was honest. And another one, arriving at the school where I worked.
Wow.
Sadly, the school has gone. It's all been demolished. It's now high-rise apartments.
What's that, a big roadblock behind you?
No, it's the entrance.
Oh,
so
right.
On either side, they had these electronic gates that would open and close. And they would close them at night, so you couldn't get out.
Oh, I see.
So eventually, that's the reason why I eventually moved out.
So the gap's either side, something comes across there, does it?
That's it. These big electronic gates will close.
Oh, right, okay.
And there's always someone on the gate as well. A gate, there's a little gatehouse. Well, there used to be. It's all gone now. It's all been demolished.
Look how skinny you were there, Mr. Duncan.
And soon I will be skinny again.
Yes.
Because I'm on my way to losing one stone of weight. One stone.
Wow, that's incredible.
I'm on the way.
The trouble is I'm losing weight as well, because we've cut out chocolate and biscuits and cakes. I'm losing weight and I don't want to.
Anyway, back to my anniversary of going to China. And there is the place you can see.
What about you, Mr. Duncan?
Well, it is kind of. It's, well, I suppose it's, you know, just give me that at least. I don't have anything else in this life. So here is the place where I worked, and you can see it's mountainous. It's in a place called Inner Mongolia. Lots of mountains and lots of power stations.
Lots of pollution.
Lots of pollution. Although the good thing was, because you were in the middle of nowhere, and literally you were in the middle of nowhere, it was actually not that polluted, because you were right near the Gobi Desert and all of the air that would constantly blow over and carry all of the pollution away. So I wouldn't say, if I was honest, I wouldn't say that it was completely polluted, if I were you. So I wouldn't say that.
That's not my memory, Mr. Duncan.
Well, your memory is different.
I think you'd got used to it. When I remember when I arrived, it was like some kind of hellhole.
Mm.
But you loved it there because you liked the people and you loved teaching English to people who were, you know, were of, let's just say they weren't rich, they were poor people.
Yes, okay.
But they wanted to learn English and you know, that's what you love doing.
Yes.
You could have chased the money in Beijing.
Yes, or Shanghai.
Or Shanghai.
Shanghai was the place where all the Westerners, all the foreigners went, all the people from the US and Europe, they would all go to Shanghai. That's where the big money was for teachers. But no, I didn't. I went to one of the poorest areas in China to teach English, and there I am. That is my first ever lesson. That's me giving my first ever lesson way back in 2003. And you can notice, if there's one thing you notice, my writing on the blackboard is huge. It's huge. And all of the students complained afterwards. They said, Mr. Duncan, you don't have to write so large on the board. So I didn't after that point. I never did it again like that. So there I am at my first class. I was really nervous. I was very scared. And then later, so this next photograph is later. And you can see I'm a little bit more relaxed. And my writing on the board has improved. It's much more neat and tidy.
I wonder what all those students are doing now, Mr. Duncan.
Yes, I hope they're doing something useful.
Yes, they look very happy.
Well, they're with me. How can you not be happy? You're with me. You're in a room with me. How can you not be happy? One thing I should mention, of course, is the food. Lots of Chinese food. I did enjoy that. But also, I suppose it's worth mentioning other things, including junk food. Look how slim I am there. Oh, my goodness. I can't believe it. I look so young. That's because I was young, by the way.
20 years ago.
Yes, I was 38. 38.
38. Wow.
Oh, my.
If only you could be that age again.
If only I could be 38 again, but I'm not, unfortunately.
What does that big R mean?
It's actually a character.
Oh,
I
right.
think it's, I want to say it's Chinese, but it could also be Japanese. I never did find out what it was. But I was eating, what am I doing there? I'm eating some KFC because I did like the junk food. And if you needed proof, here I am outside McDonald's in Beijing.
I don't know.
A huge McDonald's in Beijing. And that was during one of my visits.
And is that still there?
Oh, I think it's still there, yes. I think there's probably one on every street corner now.
Vitas says, so many girls in that picture.
Yes, well, most of my students were girls.
Mm.
They were almost, I'd say, about 85% of all the people I taught were girls. So there I am in the place I was staying and living. And that was during, I think that was during one of the Chinese New Year celebrations. And of course, I did a lot of traveling. Here I am, dressed as a Mongolian emperor, believe it or not.
We went there. I remember going there.
This actually isn't the place.
Oh.
This is actually in the grasslands. The place you went to was a display area to reenact the Mongolian grasslands. But that particular photograph is actually in the Mongolian grasslands. So that was actually the place in the middle of nowhere. And if you needed to see me in an even more odd situation, here I am on a camel, dressed once again as an emperor. I don't know why. They seem to like dressing me up as kings.
Perhaps they thought you were some kind of invader.
I don't know. But I'm on a camel there. I can't remember where it was because they used to take me all over the place.
Have you got the hump there, Mr. Duncan?
Have I got the hump?
That's a joke, Vitas.
Very good.
Has Mr. Duncan got the hump?
Here I am in the most famous landmark. When people think of China, they often think of Tiananmen Square, Heaven's Gate.
Your neck looks unfeasibly long, Mr. Duncan.
That's because I was so slim then.
Your neck looks almost as long as your head.
It does look as if my neck has been stretched.
Yes, it looks like you've been stretched.
But no, that's me. That's me 20 years ago. And now I'm going to cry.
I don't think I've seen these pictures, Mr. Duncan.
I think you have. And, of course, you know I like motorbikes.
Yes.
And I remember going to this shop, Steve, and the guy that owned the shop tried to get me to buy the motorbike.
Well, if you'd gone to a motorbike shop, that's no. Probably why.
Oh, can I finish the sentence? He said he would give me the bike for half price. He was going to give me this amazing price if I would agree to be on his posters and promote his shop. So he wanted to use me, basically.
Well, you were getting a half-price bike.
Yes, but I didn't in the end, because I suppose it's only fair to say that the roads in China are very dangerous. Many people driving on the roads in China don't even know how to drive a car because they've never taken a test, ever.
Is that because of corruption, Mr. Duncan?
It is. They just buy a license and then they drive on the road with absolutely no training whatsoever. And that's the reason why there are so many crashes.
The highest in the world, I believe, in China, the highest death rate on the roads.
I used to see at least 3 car crashes every day. Every day there would be a car somewhere on the side of the road, normally with a huge dent in the front or the side. And that's the reason why. And I'm not being racist. Before anyone says, oh, Mr. Duncan, you're being racist. I'm not being racist because I lived there and I saw it. And it's still the same. It's still the same.
Alibaba says we've got to go to Vietnam because it's beautiful, peaceful, and the food is delicious. I think we would like Vietnamese food. I think we would like, well, you certainly would. Because that's your favourite type of food. Yes. Are we playing the you-know-what today?
No, we're going in a minute.
Oh, blimey. I thought we'd have, you know.
Well, I'm not feeling exactly like doing a 2-hour show today. I'll be honest with you. If I was honest with you, which I'm being. Oh, by the way, we also had our school had a training centre. And can you believe it, Steve? I was on the front, and there I am.
Oh, yes.
And everyone said that they knew who I was because of that sign. So they actually put a photograph of me. So this is one of the training centres that we opened, and I actually ended up helping to run it.
It's not a flattering, very flattering photo.
No, it isn't. And I always said that to them. I said, could you get a better photograph of me? Instead of just... And they didn't tell me, by the way. They did not tell me that they were using my photograph. So it was one day I went by accident. And I looked and I thought, that's me. They've put me on the front of the training centre and they didn't even tell me. So there you go.
Regina says, are birthdays also anniversaries?
Regina. Can you say Regina?
Okay.
Because I think the subtitles might put something else.
Sorry, Regina. Our birthdays also anniversaries.
Yes, definitely. Happy,
definitely.
Happy anniversaries. Well, I suppose it depends how old you are.
Yeah. Yes, a birthday is an anniversary. It happens, something that happens every year. So, yeah, if it happens every year, it's an anniversary of something. In this case, it just happens to be a birthday. Could be anything. Could be, you know, Yes. Did you do wheelies on your bike, Mr. Duncan?
No, but I know if you go on Instagram or TikTok, there are people, mainly and quite often, I'm not judging anyone, but quite often in Vietnam, other places as well, but they often do it in Vietnam. They go along the road and they lift their front wheel up and go along on their back wheel. I have to say, it does look pretty cool, to be honest, but I never did it because I was always worried about my bike disappearing from underneath me. So I never had a motorbike in China, but I did have one in the UK. And to be honest with you, people in the UK also drive in a crazy way as well, including him.
Can we say something about the Paris trip?
We will mention it briefly. I'm very behind with emails because I've had loads of emails, Steve, concerning my mum's death on Thursday. So I'm literally under a pile of emails. But yes, it's still happening. So nothing's changed there because it's not until June anyway.
Yes. So we'll send an email out this week to anybody who we're going to form an email list group and to firm up the dates and everything for everybody because we need to get organizing that so that people can plan ahead. So
yes,
we'll do that this week. Anyone that's interested in coming, we'll put you on an email group and we'll sort it out that
way. Yes, you'll have to let me know first though.
So
you can't just go on the email group without getting in touch, so send me your details, and then eventually we will have a group, and we will also form a WhatsApp group as well.
Yes.
So eventually we will all be able to stay in touch, but we are not talking about the trip here. We're not giving any details here. It will all be done away from YouTube for obvious reasons, I suppose.
Yeah, anybody that's already sent Mr. Duncan an email expressing an interest in going, we'll be sending out some more communication.
Well, I have already. So everyone who's been in touch with me, I have contacted in return and told you when.
Oh, right. You've done that already?
Yes, I've done that.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah,
there's no email list required at the moment. So
good. So, Lovely. All right, Mr. Duncan. I'll go and put the kettle on.
Well, we're both going.
Right. Okay.
Yes. So thank you for joining us today. It's been a weird one. I was not sure if I was going to be here today. I wasn't feeling great on Thursday, and I wasn't feeling very well on Friday. But then I went to see Mr. Steve in his show last night, and I have to say, and I mean this, I really mean this. I was quite emotional this morning, and I said to Steve, I said, you do realize how much help that was last night. Going out, I could have stayed at home. I could have sat and felt really sorry for myself, but it was nice experiencing a bit of socializing, being with people and watching lots of other people have fun and joy. So it was great. Thank you, Steve, and thank you as well. We will be back next Sunday, hopefully in slightly better circumstances. We can only wish, but of course, who knows? Who knows what's going to happen next in this crazy world?
And Mr. Duncan's putting on some short videos, aren't you? So look out for those as well. Some of you might have already seen them.
Mm.
Some short email. If you've already sent an email, by the way, about the trip, you don't need to send another one.
Mm.
But Christina says she's going to send an email.
That's it. So Definitely. If you are interested in meeting up in Paris, if there is anything left of Paris, of course, because at the moment it's all on fire. I hope there is something left, because have you heard also all of the utilities have gone on strike as well, including the people that take the rubbish away.
Oh, blimey.
So the streets of Paris at the moment are piled high with garbage.
Really?
And apparently it stinks. So,
Lewis can tell us what's going on. How long are they on strike for?
Permanently. Everything. Everything's come by June. Yes, everything's come to a standstill. There are huge riots taking place, and they want to get rid of the president And that's all I'm saying about that. But I hope it's all back to normal by the time we go there in June. That's all I can say.
Right. Lovely to see you all and read about you all, of course. And thank you for your lovely messages today. And see you at absolute minimum next Sunday.
Yes. Next Sunday, we are back. We'll be here together for you. Hopefully, it will be a little bit longer. And, of course, thanks for joining me. A little bit of reminiscing today. 20 years since I went to China, and also the start of the Iraq invasion on this day.
Let's end on a happy note, Mr. Yeah. Duncan.
How strange, though. What a strange coincidence.
Yes. Anyway, yes, you landed and the bombs started falling, didn't they?
Yes.
Right. Have a lovely week, everyone. And if you're celebrating any anniversaries, let us know and we'll talk about it next week.
Yes, definitely. This is Mr. Duncan and Mr. Steve saying thanks for watching. See you soon. And of course, until the next time we meet, you know what's coming next. Yes, you do. Are you ready?
No.
Ta-ta for now.